39.
I just turned it on so we have a picture of this. Okay. All right. That looks, that's, yeah, you're quite the historian, Billy.
Yeah. In fact, I had crawled down to get a shot of Joel because everybody was singing to him, but he had his back to us. And so I got down. So my video is very shaky because I was hand holding it on while I was kind of squatting below everybody. And but I noticed it when I panned up. I said, well, there's evidence that Joe Terra's washboard was there because it's got it written right on there, you know. But anyway.
So he gave it to Franny on what date of 89? What
October 3rd, October 3rd, 89.
And that would make sense, right at the end of the summer season, October 3rd. Mm-hmm. What happened, what they used to do in Wildwood is they were open full time every night from like Memorial Day to Labor Day. And then at Labor Day, they'd open only on weekends for another month.
Yeah. I have a little narrative that John McLernan emailed me, and I'll bring it up when everybody's online so we can in the Zoom so we can talk about it.
Cool.
You know. Anyway.
Yeah, that was, it's amazing you found that.
Yeah, well, it was one of those things that I remembered us talking about him having a washboard there, and I said, well, I had a close up from down under, and it also corresponds with they had asked if I could find a clip of Peter Babcock singing, and I've got a couple of those from the 50th reunion. Of course, he wasn't at the new one, the latest one. He was dead. So, yeah. Here's David Krippner.
He's David Krippner.
So, Barry, is Dottie enjoying you being home all the time, day and night now?
She stays in the living room. I stay in the garage, and we're happy.
Yeah, well, y'all had a nice picture of your together. She posted last week.
Yeah, I saw that.
Hey, David.
Where you at, David?
Hello, gentlemen. How y'all doing?
Out of David, who came in?
Good. Yeah, I just heard you. You were about to say how you're enjoying retired life, Barry.
Yeah, it's fine.
More time for the grandkids.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I'm doing, picking up grandkids now. That now that I don't have to go to work, I pick up grandkids.
That's a good hobby. Better than a hobby, yeah.
So what's happening in the mountains, Dave?
I've been hoping, and we got some snow. It's been snowing all day, but it was so faint, and it's right around 32, so it was, you know, it was melting before it hit the ground, but it was still fun to look at. But finally, in the last hour or so, it hit the magic point, and it's starting to cover things. So, yeah, it's magic time in the mountains.
That's good.
Yeah, so the little dogs have to run out quickly.
Yeah, I just tried one a minute ago, and she wouldn't bite. She said, uh-uh.
You have dachshunds?
Yeah, three.
Yeah,
three.
They don't have much ground clearance, you know?
No, they don't. And before this all happened, you know, the grass hadn't really been growing well. No, I think we have some kind of mixture out there in the back that seemed to keep growing. But anyway, so I trimmed it before a week or two ago when I thought we were going to have some snow. Just so that they could have as much clearance as possible.
But yeah, you have to cut them little ruts that they can get to the trees, right? So they can.
Well, what we did one time is we put down a tarp, you know, about a 8x10 tarp, and then when they time for them to go out, we roll the tarp back, kind of like a football field, only smaller.
Yeah, I guess. That would be kind of cold if you're running out there dragging your wee-wee in the snow. There.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
I mean, the last time I tried it, I didn't like it.
What, dragging your wee-wee in the snow?
That's right. Just kidding. We don't get enough snow around here for that.
Well, I realized that Nola was pretty smart because I put her outside on the deck. Hope, you know, like she'd go out and pee, but she scooted underneath the table that was like an umbrella. And Pete there, and that's where she was peeing for a week or so. And I go, okay, well, you're not too stupid.
Smart girl, yeah. Smart girl.
Yeah. Yeah, boy.
So, David, I'm gonna be going to California for 5 weeks next week.
Five weeks.
Yeah, I'll be able to help a lot, but I was gonna send you the login and all that stuff, and I'll give you a call and talk to you about if Billy gets tied up.
Sounds good. 5 weeks all at one time.
Yeah, all at one time.
Gee whiz, that's great.
Good visit with those grandkids. You're staying at your son's condo.
Yeah, the son has a condo, and then they're up at their house. So, yeah, you know, his wife is from Germany, and she's into this. Her mother's been coming over a lot, and we just have to be around a little while to.
Yeah. How long of a drive is it from the condo to the hilltop?
15 minutes.
That's all. Mm-hmm.
Nice. Yeah, so it's not.
Have they been having the deluge there? Has that been getting?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, they've been. It's strange out there because they're in a drought, but all the water keeps going into the ocean, so it's not really fixing the drought.
Mm. Oh, they have no reservoirs or nothing.
Well, they have a lot of that stuff, but they're. A lot of the water is going into the ocean, but now the snowpack, they have like 8 feet of snow. That's going to help a lot.
Yeah.
It's going to be a nice slow melting.
Right, right. And all those landslides they're having too.
Well, that's after you have fires and then there's nothing to hold the ground.
Yeah.
And then the rain comes and it's kind of crazy out there.
Is that going to hurt our wine production?
Well, there was a big article. Is it smoky wine? Or do the grapes have a smoky taste? I'll stick to my beer.
Yeah, I like a good bottle of wine, but
there was another article in the San Francisco paper. Now a glass of wine in San Francisco is averaging $17.
What?
A glass of wine?
A $17 bottle of wine is pretty expensive for me.
Yeah, I think I'd be stomping grapes in my bathtub.
Oh, gosh.
Do like Lucy and Ethel.
Yeah. But I saw they were having, there's some people growing grapes in Louisiana making wine.
Oh, yeah, no, there's some vineyards not far from my house. They have a concerts like during the wine season, whenever they harvest and start making a wine, where you can go to dine in the vines or something like that, and they have a little music.
I haven't ever done it.
It seems like it's one of those things on our list to do, but we've never done it yet.
I did about 5 days for a winery in Virginia because there's a big tie between France and Virginia wine, and the owner was coming from Italy, and they said, can you be here Tuesday morning? I said, well, no, I have a job, but I'll be there Tuesday afternoon. I said, but we got a lot to do, so, be ready. He goes, well, what time can you be here? I said, 1. He goes, we'll eat lunch at 1. And I realized that he wasn't going to be quick, and I just said, okay. So I get there at 1. Nobody speaks English except me, but I had this wonderful time. I mean, we didn't get out into the fields to do the owner talking until 4 o'clock. And when I got home, it was like, I got to check and see if this is in focus because I was lit up really well. I had a ball.
Yeah.
But
so you tried a bunch of different types of vino.
Yeah. And well, then one day I show up. Everybody there was from Italy and they were all, family. And the guy who was running the vineyards, his mother was there. Well, I had taken some still pictures of his mother and I just show up and give him some still. It was like I gave him $1 million. Get him a case of wine. So they gave me a whole case. I said, no, it's okay. You're already paying me to do the video. I just took the pictures to be nice and get him a case of wine. Okay.
Hey man, wine don't go bad. Just bring it home, just don't leave it out in the sun.
The cool thing was I brought the Cabernet Sauvignon is what they gave me. So I brought that home, but I also brought a bunch of Cabernet grapes home.
Oh, just the grapes themselves, yeah.
Yeah, and that was fun to put them in your mouth and crunch them.
Where was this vineyard?
This was in Barboursville, Virginia. It was like a 2-hour drive for me. But there was this thing where, if I can get this right, Thomas Jefferson, who had Monticello in Virginia, he sent, let's see, France sent Thomas Jefferson a bunch of clippings, which they planted through Virginia. Then, and I think like the 40s or the 50s, there was this big blight in France. So then Virginia sent a bunch of clippings back and reestablished the grapes over there. So there was this big tie between them.
Yeah, nice.
But they do the same thing as you were talking about, Billy. They have these parties and these drinking things. They make a lot of money off of having people come in.
Yeah. Yeah. And here's another little piece of memorabilia that was from the 50th reunion. I went back through the 50th reunion stuff because they had asked for things with Peter Babcock singing and all. But I just noticed this. And this was some mustache gals from, let me get that thing out of here. Oops, wrong page. Get back here. From, I guess, maybe somebody recognizes who these girls are.
Oh, there's Kent.
Yeah. Kent McBride was actually holding this thing in his hand. And these two girls that are right next to Bob Osborne were there at the 50th reunion.
I remember the ladies that came. I don't remember in this picture.
And
they were
And I don't know that isn't Roger on
that's
the
Roger, yeah.
Is Roger on the bottom? Okay.
Roger on the bottom. Jim Stanzak on top.
Jim Stanzak.
Yeah.
Jim Stanzak.
And I don't know who that is.
McBride, Bob Osborne, Roger, and I know this guy, but I can't think of his name.
It's not Eddie. Oh, it must be Ed Cribbs.
It's not Ed Lee. No.
How about Ed Cribbs?
I don't think Edwin. Well, maybe it could be Edwin. Could be.
Yeah. That's a good. That's a great picture.
The girl. Yeah,
it was on. It was one of our Thursday night beer chugging contest brochures.
Yeah.
That Kent was holding in his hand, and I just took a still of it with my camera.
The girl right in the middle, she was a waitress at the Mustache, and she ended up over at Houlihan's when we were playing at Houlihan's. She was a manager at Houlihan's, and she, in fact, showed up for the 50th Carnegie thing.
Yeah, I remember. Right. There was two of them that showed up.
In fact, two girls in the picture were there.
They were friends of Big Bill.
Okay.
Everybody was a friend of Big Bill.
But they were close to Big Bill.
If they worked at Houlihan's, then Kent must know them, or at least the one.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway. Okay. So. Oh, hey, Chris.
Hey, how you doing, guys?
Chris is in Italy.
Chris, you're in Italy? Oh, my God.
11 o'clock at night.
Oh, no.
He only joined us because he's had a couple of vinos tonight.
Well, I have. Matter of fact, that's one of my routines here is to have a little vino with dinner every night. It's delicious local wine and very inexpensive. And it just sort of sets your evening on a calm pace.
your son lives there, doesn't he?
My daughter is right across the hallway. Yeah.
Hey, Mike.
Hi, guys. How you doing?
Hey, Mike.
Chris, long time, man.
Yeah, I know. Haven't seen you. Well, we missed a couple over the holidays. Yeah. Missed a couple of meetings, so this is my first chance to get back in and see you guys. And I thought even if it's in Rome, I can sneak it in. I'll stay up a little later than I normally do.
Oh, are you in Rome now?
Yeah.
Oh, cool, man.
Yeah, I'll be here until March. So.
Oh wow, that's nice.
So is this half work and half fun vacation?
Oh, it's all vacation.
Excellent.
Well, I gather recipes and things like that, and you know, I did a show recently called "When in Rome," which was a collection of things that I put together last year, And then we made a show about them, and that'll be on your local stations starting in March somewhere. They're okay. delivering the shows January the 15th. So no, not 15th, 16th.
Okay,
it'll be going out on Monday.
Yeah, I'm glad we're finally going to get to see him. I think you told me that y'all were using him for a fundraiser up there, and
yeah, all the stations will be doing the same.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah, yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Celebrity.
See, Barry, now that you've given up Fritzl's, you can go to San Francisco for 5 weeks. You can go to Rome for a month or two or three.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Come on down. You'll love it. Rome is great. And the weather can't be beat. You know, it's like in the 50s every day, maybe the 60s.
Well, you sure don't want to be anywhere near California right now.
No, you do not. Unless you have your bathing suit on and you're ready to.
And a life vest.
And a life vest, yeah.
Now, do you have any connections there at the Vatican?
No, absolutely none. But, you know, it's interesting that since I've been here, two cardinals have died. Oh. And so, you know, you can't even get near the Vatican. All of these pilgrims come in to see dead cardinals. I don't know what the attraction is, but yeah, they all look the same to me. They're all dead, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Pope died too, the ex Pope.
Hey, yeah, Rick. Right.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, Rick. Hey, Rick.
Hello. No, but actually the Popehood is kind of close in my family. I had a distant relative, Nicole Sicola, and he came really close on when they were voting on the Pope and they burned the ballots and all that.
Yeah,
and it didn't come up white smoke though, because they decided they didn't want a pope called Pope Sicola.
Oh man!
Oh no!
Oh, yeah.
William.
All right.
Oh God! I should have seen that coming.
Anyway, Mike sent me I finally got to look at the videos you sent me from the second mustache reunion band from 1998. The tracking on my machine, it's not great, but it's the audio is really good. I have a clip. This is from your father's mustache reunion band in 1998, and I've just one clip from the opening of it. You still there, Mike? Okay, you're right. Okay, here we go. Let me see if I can get this up here. Let me first. Okay.
Yeah, I don't know how good some of those tapes are, Bill. They're pretty old. And
yeah, well, I loaded it in and see what how it looks to you guys. It's
we're all pretty old too, so
that's what I was thinking. I don't know how my tracking's doing.
Yeah.
Let me start. That's good.
Does it look nice and blue to you? Just the first 3 or 4 minutes up to the audio's good. And they start playing.
This is what's known as the Your Father's Mustache Reunion Band. All of these ladies and gentlemen played with the, alas, gone, but not forgotten, Your Father's Mustache Nightclubs, 1962 through 1972, all the way from New Orleans to New York to California to Denver to Europe. They were all over the world. Ah, well. Mourn. But the good news is that during that period of time, we hired an extraordinary number of people working their way through college. And in a large number of cases, those people have gone on and done wonderful things, presidents of companies, lawyers, doctors, all the other important professions. Unfortunately, those people were unable to come today. What we have left is those people who still are existing on the fumes of Your Father's Mustache 25 years ago. Those people whose life, that was the high point, and it's going downhill ever since. And here they are reliving for a brief moment those golden days of yesterday. We were all young. Anyway, here we go.
Excellent.
That was good.
Who was the trombone?
Who was that playing the trombone?
Lenny Kissonen.
What?
Lenny Kissonen.
Lenny Kissonen.
Okay. I didn't know Lenny.
Was Big Bill walking in front?
Was what?
Was that Big Bill Sawyer walking in the front trying to get?
Oh, no, no. That's Doug Grazan.
Doug Grazan.
Bill, I think Bill was over in Thailand by then, and I don't think he ever came back once he got over there.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's Doug Grazan. He lives in Columbus, Ohio.
Yeah. Well, I recorded the whole concert. Some of it isn't that shaky. It looked like they were trying to handhold it, but the last part of it, whoever was handholding the camera got up closer so they didn't have to, like, you know. And it's but the tracking on my machine, it didn't match up real good. So.
Yeah.
But it sounds good.
The sound was good.
It was good.
You can tell who it is, you know.
It was adorable.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, let's see.
What year was that, 1998?
Yeah, that was 98. We did it in, I think it was 97, 98, 99, and 2000. Something like that. I don't know if it went, it might have gone a little longer, but I've got tapes on a lot of stuff, but I've been going through a bunch of things, some things I can't find. So I have four or five copies of that. So I thought I'd get it to Bill. And if I can ever find 99 or anything else, I'll get that to you too, Bill.
Yeah. I think 2000 you gave me and it came out good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I sent that up to Chris already. I think he put that up already. Anyway.
Well, Joan asked me to tell you guys about Danny Sullivan. So can you see this?
Yeah, I can see it.
Multiple medical issues, this fall a stroke in her eye, then recent hospitalization and surgery complicated by her compromised general health. And then she gets COVID in the hospital.
Oh, Lord.
So anyway, she's in the Bay Breeze Rehab, 1026 Alba Farm Road, Venice, Florida, 34285. 1-941-484-0425 if anybody, a lot of people watch these videos, so if anybody knows her down there, you might give her a call. I don't know who Danny Sullivan is, so.
She's a sweetheart. She was she was married to Bob Vanacek years ago, and then the banjo player, and then Jim Sullivan for a long time. Jim passed away a couple of years ago. They had both had some really severe health problems for several years. Can you put that up one more time? I didn't get the address quite down.
Sure.
Was she at the reunion of the 50th?
No. But no, I don't think she was.
Now, there were several ladies there, but I didn't know who any of them were. So
anyway, it's not the biggest
Clearwater concert. The one we did in Clearwater for Joan. Yeah. She was at that one.
So it's at the Bay Breeze Rehab. 1026 Alba, ALBEE Farm Road, Venice, Florida, 34285.
Yeah, Danny did a lot of washboards with concerts with us in Connecticut and California and Ohio for years. And I was red, white, and blue stars and striped sequin vests and cowboy hats. And somewhere along the way, she got the nickname the Energizer Bunny. And she was always really a real addition, real good addition to the washboard concerts we did for over a period of almost 40 years.
Wow. You got some health problems, that's for sure.
I got the address down now. Thank you very much.
Sure. Like I said, there seems to be, I looked on the YouTube thing and there's usually like between 15 and 20 people that watch the videos.
Okay.
So some other people might see it and get a hold of her.
Yeah. Here's Roger.
Hey.
Hey, Roger.
Hey, Roger. Hi, Roger.
What's up, guys? How you doing?
Hey, Roger.
Yeah.
We're doing.
We're doing what we used to do. I don't think so.
Well, not quite.
What's that, being silly? That's about all I can do anymore. I can't do anything else.
Oh yeah, Gim has a job today, so he's not coming.
Who's not coming?
Gim.
Oh, okay. Well, he likes to keep busy, so.
Yeah. Well, somebody last week had asked about clips of Peter Babcock.
Peter Babcock.
Oh yeah.
But was it Ira or who was it that asked? Because I can wait for Ira to get on because I have a couple clips of him doing some business. we had, let me see if I can get the right thing here. Let's see, I'm looking for Joe Terra washboard. Let's see. Here we go. Let me pull up this little video clip. This was at the 50th reunion, and the camera work is a little shaky because I decided to try to get down up close to the band where I could see Joel too. So it has good shots of Franny's butt and Joel's face. and it also has a very good shot of Joe Terra's washboard that somebody else was playing there. But let me get.
Were you drinking?
Was I drinking? Everybody was drinking. We were drinking.
I hope so. Yeah. Keep normal.
All right. Oh, what the heck's going on here? Okay. Video. Got to get to the right folder. Hold on. Here it is. Excuse the shaky camera work. Make it bigger. Come on, get bigger, boy. That's what they all know.
Oh,
You did. I called my wife. Okay.
That was exciting. Oh, like
yeah. The guy playing Joe Terra's washboard was Bill Dern.
Yep.
You have to get that to Franny, man.
Yeah, Roger, that Billy has a shot of the washboard that says it was from Joe Terra.
Oh, I'm sorry, this is the wrong picture. Hold on. Let's see. Let me get the right picture here. Share screen. Come on, what's the matter? It's not showing the right picture. Okay. Let me try it again here. Okay, just give me a second. It should be there now. Okay. I'm going to get it.
No problem, Bill.
There we go. There we are.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Now, you see, I did a freeze frame of what I did so you can see.
That well, that's cool.
He had written on the washboard, on the pan, to Buddy Boy Franny from Buddy Boy Joe Terra, October 3rd, 1989.
Wow, that's cool, man.
Yeah.
And Barry said that Barry has some information about that.
Where did he go? I would believe that was the closing night of the Red Garter,
mm-hmm.
89, because that was Joe's last job at the Red Garter down in New Jersey. That was Franny's territory. Mm-hmm. So he probably was playing banjo. Mm-hmm. And that's probably the last gig Joe played right there.
Yeah. Yeah, in fact, John McLernan piped in, sent me an email directly when I told him I had a picture of Joe Terra's washboard. But he must watch our Zoom video meetings or something. But and he said, "Hi, Bill." He says, "Yeah, there are several of Joe's washboards floating around. Franny Smith has one that Joe gave him to store while we were still playing summers at the Red Goita in North Wildwood. We would occasionally have gigs to offer Joe through the winter, especially if the client requested Joe. Having washboard already down there in South Jersey meant Joe didn't have to transport one on the bus to and from New York. He didn't like having gear in his hands when he used to use the PATH train, the bus station, and the New York subways going home at night. He said it would invite muggings. Joe said the would-be robbers would run at you as if to start a fight, and you'd drop your stuff to defend you. Meanwhile, an accomplice would grab what you just dropped. So I guess he was afraid of somebody nabbing his washboard. So he said, when Carnegie was on the horizon, Franny offered to let Bill Dern use Joe's washboard since Bill was coming from the left coast and already had both feet amputated due to diabetes. Franny and I brought the washboard with us to New York, and Franny still has it in his garage. So
had both feet amputated?
Bill Dern. Yeah.
Who? Yeah. Bill.
That's Bill what Dern? John McLernan chimed in. He's really a historian, quite a historian of stuff. It's like, anyway.
Yeah.
Wow. Crazy guy. So
Roger, do you know Danny Sullivan?
Danny Sullivan?
Yeah. The woman.
No, I don't believe
Gunny.
I saw that when I first came on.
Well, that's Joan sent this, Joan Dragon, and this is just
down from Florida.
That was Bob Vanaset's wife, Roger.
Oh, well, his wife or his girlfriend?
Well, I don't know whether they were married or not.
I don't know.
I thought they were married.
He had a wife at the same time he had a full time girlfriend.
Unusual.
Yeah, and in Denver, his wife would never come to the club, but his girlfriend would come there a lot. And then he moved to the East Coast, and I don't know if he got a divorce in because the girlfriend moved to the East Coast, and she was an artist, I believe.
Yeah, that's Danny. She's an artist. Yeah. She's an art teacher and stuff, and they lived in Detroit or somewhere for quite a while. She and her husband, Jim Sullivan, and then they moved to Florida years ago. Hmm. And they were heavily involved in the Clearwater Festival for a long time.
That's the last time I saw her, the Clearwater.
Yeah.
Hmm. What month does Joni do that Clearwater thing? She's still doing it?
It's November.
Oh, in November. Yeah, that's when all the snowbirds are there. Yeah.
That's a really good festival.
Yeah. Roger, this is a picture I put up earlier about, it was a flyer we had from one of our beer chugging contest flyers. That's what I was, boy, I tell you what's wrong with this thing. Okay, it keeps putting the wrong thing back up here. Okay,
I'm trying too many beers.
Picture of the strippers from Bourbon Street.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
What the hell's going on?
It always keeps trying to pop up the last picture I showed.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Got some characters in that picture.
Yeah. That was our flyer for the beer chugging night.
Yeah. We had a we had an international beer chugging contest also, where people came from different parts of the United States even. I forgot what they were going to win, some trip to New York or something. Mm. And we had judges. Arcus Kelly was one judge, and Warren Spotswood was another one, and I was the third judge. We're all dressed up in tuxedos and everything. And and we had all these people in there. That's a big deal. I don't think they ever got their free trip, but it was a big deal.
The fastest chugger I ever saw there was Char Niehaus. Remember Char?
Oh, yeah. He could suck it down.
He could suck it down. I mean, in a quarter of a second, 8 ounces. Boom.
Zoom.
We had a guy like that in Denver. His name was, I don't know, remember what his real name was, but his nickname was Tank. And anytime he was in there for those things, he won. I could place third a lot of times, but that's the best I ever got.
Mm-hmm.
I think there in Mardi Gras sometimes would have a manager's beer chugging contest. Managers from all different clubs would get up and practice how fast they could chug down beer. Well, what a way to live, huh?
Does anybody know who the guy is right behind Kent McBride? Is that
up there with the mug up in the air?
Yeah.
Oh, what's his name?
You might know him.
His face is for me, but the name ain't.
I know his face. I just can't put the name with it.
Yeah. I recognize him, but I can't. Yeah, I can't think of it.
And remember, whoever was the MC of the beer chugging contest would say, "And the rules are no excess spillage."
Yeah. Yeah, you can't just dump it down. You can't just dump it down your shirt or another one. Yeah.
No excess spillage.
Yeah. Yeah,
I like that, Pastor. Tom, you had a picture that I wanted, a picture of me during Mardi Gras with a t-shirt on with a frog on it.
Okay, when did I show it?
You just showed it, or maybe somebody showed it. It was before the Christmas vacation.
Okay, let me look through some of the files.
Because just after that, we took a 2-week break or whatever. And I wasn't here last weekend, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wonder what happened to Snake.
Yeah,
he usually comes here every week. I hope he's okay.
Yeah, Snake was here last week, yeah.
Yeah, he was here last week.
Who's that?
Snake.
Oh, really? Oh, wow, yeah.
Y'all remember the time in New Orleans when we were doing a beer guzzling contest, Billy and Roger, and Bill Dana came into the club.
Yeah.
Remember that? Bill Dana, Jose Jimenez. Oh, yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. So we had it set up. Three waiters went up there to chug beer. It might have been you, Roger. Said, what's your name? Where are you from? My name, Jose Jimenez. That person. What's your name? My name, Jose. What's your name? My name, Jose Jimenez.
Right.
And said, will the real Jose Jimenez please stand up?
Really?
Bill Dana stood up in the audience.
Yeah.
He was big at the time.
Oh, yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah,
remember
he was. Night.
Yeah.
That was his pick. Yeah.
Yeah. I was there. I remember that night. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was fun. The real Bill Dana, please stand up.
I remember Jack Nicklaus came in and I waited on him. He gave me a $5 tip, and that was big money back then.
There you go.
That was big money, a $5 tip.
Really? Yeah.
We used to get quarters.
Yeah. Yeah, when I was working there, my rent was only $74 a month, so $5 is.
Yeah, really. I had a place in a quarter on St. Peter Street. Walk down St. Peter Street and take a left, St. Peter Street. I think I only paid $90 or $100 a month. Mm-hmm. It was back in the back part of it. Then they called it the slave quarters. Yeah. And it was one flight up and just a long, narrow room, little kitchen at one end, little bathroom at the other end. But I put a little dividers up in it.
Well, you were right behind the Maison Bourbon then, right?
Yeah. What's that?
Right behind the Maison Bourbon.
Yeah, but it was on the other side of the street,
819. Yeah, the other side of the street. Right. Yeah.
On the same side of the street was Charlie Vagabond had an apartment there. He and his wife paid.
So you were right behind what now is the karaoke place. What do they call that? Karaoke. Yeah.
Cat's Meow.
Cat's Meow.
Yeah.
Where was Dixie's? Was it that?
Same building.
Yeah, that's what I said. That was the first place that I remember being there.
Yeah.
Dixie's, I believe. I have a picture of that with snow on it.
I remember that big house y'all rented on Esplanade. They had quite a few mustache people all renting little rooms in it.
Yeah. Fred
was there. I lived down on the main level.
Yeah.
And Joanne Clevenger and her wife lived next door to me.
Speaking of Dixie, I was just going through the pictures, and there's the Dixie. That's the original mustache people.
Yeah, that was when it opened up. I think that's the summer of 65.
Look at the sign back there. We would sell Confederate hats instead of skimmers.
Yeah, well, we got rid of some of those hats. Yeah, we then got into the skimmer hats yet.
Yeah.
Some of those people were still there when I arrived. I came down there that following summer from Cape Cod.
Mm-hmm.
David Rao was the manager. And he went on vacation and never came back. Joel sent him on his vacation. Dalton Diamond, you guys know Dalton Diamond?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's up there in the right hand corner.
Oh, okay.
I don't see anyone else you guys might know.
Hey, you guys, I'm gonna sign off. I've got a really bad toothache and I'm gonna just try to sleep for a while, but it's good to see y'all. I'll see you next week.
Okay, Mike.
Yeah, bye, Mike.
Bye, Mike.
Take care, y'all.
Did you see
him? Hey, everybody.
There he is. Hey, Ira.
It takes me so long to get on to join the meeting. It's like 8 tries I have to go through.
That's because
it's always that way.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what that Florida electricity down there, you know?
Yeah. We're lucky we have electric.
Does anybody else have trouble getting on?
Huh?
Last time I did.
This time I got right on.
Well, what does it do when you have trouble getting on? It just doesn't go through?
It just won't go on. I kept joining meeting. Nothing happens.
Huh. Yeah.
And then eventually it happens.
Did you show your ID?
Yes. I showed him your father's mustache card. The Joe Terra card I showed.
Very good. Very good.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, I'm always amazed that it actually works.
It's only cyberspace.
Yeah.
I have that clip. Somebody was asking for something with Peter Babcock, and this was from the 50th reunion down in the bar. Let's see.
Where's the clip taken?
This was in the bar at the hotel.
Oh yeah, in the. Oh, That was great.
A lot of energy.
Yeah. What a great clip.
Mm-hmm. It was a good clip.
The guy's always on. He was always on. I bet he's in the grave still on.
Right. There you go.
Yes, he is. He was constantly on.
He was good.
But he was funny. Where was that? At Carnegie?
Yeah.
That was in the lobby. Yeah, at the hotel.
Yeah. We had a big room there.
Yeah, with that. In fact, right when you first walked in, there was a big mustache, your father's mustache display, and
yes,
and right. The band was down in the lobby playing. And was, yeah, you were there, but you were there, Ira.
Yeah, I remember it.
Yeah.
Well, I was looking for Roger's picture, but I found Les Musket.
Yeah,
they look alike.
Yeah, same thing.
They both drive old cars.
What car is that?
Something in New Orleans. Whitman and Martina, Decatur Street.
It's an old Oyster truck.
M&M.
Yeah.
Oh, that's an oyster place. Yeah.
It used to just deliver stacks of oysters off the back of those things.
Right. That's an old oyster truck. Right. Cool.
Yeah, he was good. You can still run into Babs around Jackson Square. I've done that several times in recent years. She's still out there selling parts.
That's interesting. I like it when these pictures pop up. Cool.
So I'm trying to find yours, Roger. But you had a frog on you. That's it.
It's a picture with a green T-shirt, and in the middle of the T-shirt is a picture of a frog.
All right.
People used to give me frogs all the time because they thought I was a frog prince. Hey, that's true.
You were just trying to get people to kiss you.
Well, you know.
Did it work?
I wanted to make it easy.
Yeah. Yeah. I already showed this picture a couple times, but it was Joe. I found a shot of Joe Terra's washboard. Let me see where to go. Oh heck, it keeps disappearing. At the 50th reunion, and I had a little story behind it from John McLaren, said that Bill Dern had gotten the washboard to play at the reunion from Joe back in, he got it from Franny. Here it is right there. This is just a still frame from the washboard itself. I was kind of down shooting and I noticed, I don't know if you can read that.
Yeah.
It says to Buddy,
Buddy Boy Franny.
Yeah, from Buddy Boy Joe Terra, October 3rd, 1989.
That's definitely Joe's washboard.
Yeah, yeah. And, Franny had the washboard in his possession, but he brought it to the reunion along with so that Bill Dern could play it. They said he used Joe's washboard since he was coming from the West Coast and had both his feet amputated. And I don't know what that had to do with him bringing a washboard, but I guess he didn't want to have to take tow.
Wasn't Bill Dern a banjo player?
Yes, at one time.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, Ira, you and I went and saw him at Nathan's Hot Dogs down in Times Square one time.
Who, Billy Dern?
Me, you, and Danny went up there, and we saw Bill Dern playing at Nathan's in Times Square.
I don't remember that.
Yeah.
Times Square, not the one on 8th Street, then. You said Times Square.
I thought it was Times Square.
Yeah. Well, most likely it would have been. Huh. Bill Dern.
He was part of the Fordham gang.
Was he?
Yeah, he went to Fordham.
Well, so did Dave Hunt.
Yeah, Dave went there.
He went to Fordham.
Mike Malarney. They're the ones who told me to come down to the New York club and get a job as a waiter because they said they were making good money.
At the time, it was good money because it was money.
It was good money.
Yeah.
And Keith Keith Ramsdell said, we don't need any more waiters. I'm up to my asshole in waiters. He says, we need banjo players.
You know about a banjo?
I'll tell you what, it was nice when I was in college. You go home with cash in your pocket every night.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You need this clear cash. And, you know, I always liked it when we closed the doors and the lights weren't on yet. And when the lights came on, everyone was looking around the floor for money and change. I found lots of money that way.
Yeah, me too. Especially with all the peanut shells on the floor too. Still, we get buried under there.
Yeah, just really.
Kicking it around. And,
yeah.
I found when I was at Cape Cod, Fred and I were up there when I first started working, and we cleaned the club the next day, to make some money so we could live back in the chicken coop. And one morning we went over and started sweeping, and I found $100 bill.
Really?
I should have thought I was a millionaire.
They didn't have much of a chance of breaking a $100 bill at the mustache. we wouldn't take anything over a 20.
$100 bill in those years was a lot of money.
Yeah. Oh, God. I remember we wouldn't take anything over a 20, I don't think.
Well, we didn't have
a lot.
I think
you're right. I think we did. Yeah.
Yeah. Or maybe go to the bartender. And
And you had to tell them to place the money the right way, or you wasn't going to change
it. That's right. Your money ain't turned the right way. I'm keeping it.
Really?
Keep the change.
Yeah.
Well. Oh boy, those were the days.
Yeah.
Well, you know, interesting thing of all the people who worked at the mustache, it doesn't make any difference if they worked a year, 2 years, 4 or 5 years, or more. Then when they get together, there's also this whole aura of the camaraderie that, you know, it's still alive and everything. It's Barry, how long did you work the most? You must have worked about 8 or 9 years.
I worked from 69 to 76. 69 to 76.
Yeah.
7 years.
7 years.
Yeah, I worked for Joe for almost 11 years total.
Oh,
wow. Mm-hmm. I worked there 5 years.
Yeah.
I think Gim was the longest one in this Zoom call. He's not here now, but I think Gim was there a long time.
Yeah, he was the very first banjo player Joel hired.
Well, he and Ronnie Bill.
Yeah.
Well, look at Terry. He played washboard for 10 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Jeff was in that picture right behind him when he was when you say on the washboard, you know.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, Jeff and
He was sitting back there playing banjo.
Yeah, I mean, I started Mardi Gras of 71, and I stopped. I think Mardi Gras 75. I really stopped working there a lot in September of 74, because I had got out of college and got a job at the TV station. But I would go back on weekends, and I think I went back for that Mardi Gras on New Year's because they usually need people, and it was nice to go home and go there and make a few bucks, you know.
Yeah.
Tom, here's a picture that I'm sort of looking for, but it's by myself.
Oh.
Yeah, okay.
That's you and Krebs, huh?
but it was in color.
Yeah, so I'm looking for it. I'm looking.
It was that same day.
Hmm.
Because that's before that, I had a beard and I shaved it off the Mardi Gras day.
Did I just like it on one of our Zooms, or did I use it for the intro, for the picture, for the invite?
Oh, no. I thought you used it in the when we're on in Zoom.
Okay.
Well, maybe not.
It's so hard for me to tell what I did.
I've been going to my laptop and my phone. I said, I got so damn many photographs. It's ridiculous.
Mm.
I try to organize them.
That's a job in itself.
Oh, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Well, here's a really short video clip I can play while y'all are waiting for see if Tom can find that. Let's see. Let me see if I can get this up here. This is also from the 50th reunion upstairs. It's only about a minute long.
Well, it's a big room we had upstairs. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
So, Brett, what are the odds they're going to finish up with Dixie?
I don't know. We're in New York. If we were in New Orleans, there wouldn't be any doubt about it.
Could have used those trombones in New Haven, right, Bear?
Oh, really? Jesus.
Yeah, I think Danny would agree with you.
Yeah. He did end with Dixie, huh?
Yeah, he did. That's right. In fact, I was just debating because they played the whole Glory, Glory, Hallelujah song, and I saw Fred, and that's why I was asking, you think they're going to finish with Dixie? And he didn't think so, but they did. You know, so, yeah.
They were deciding what music to play at Carnegie Hall, and they were one to play that melody with Dixie and all that stuff. I said, I don't think we should play that now, but they went ahead and played it anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, back then, that was still 2010, you know, or 2011, 2010.
Don't ask hard questions.
Yeah.
What the hell?
No, wait a minute. When was it? 2012, I guess, huh?
Yeah,
2012. 2011.
For what, the reunion?
Yeah.
2011, I think.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. It was not politically correct, but it wasn't quite as taboo as it is today. You know?
No, it wasn't. I just, that was my feelings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And another really short clip, and I don't remember, I think it was just finishing off something. Let's see. There we go. It's only a half a minute long. Right at the very end of us, the band, because just before that, we had all the roasts or the mustache stories, and then the band played for a while. I enjoyed that myself more than the concert at Carnegie, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And everybody had it. I liked it, all the stories people were sharing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, because I've been showing mostly the New Haven stuff, but, you know, I still have a lot of things from Carnegie to put up there, you know. So
you're right, Roger. A lot of these years, everybody still gets together and talks, a lot of camaraderie. It's just some good times. Good times.
That's, well, Chris is talking to us like about midnight in Rome here.
Yep.
Oh. His eyes are getting heavy.
I know.
That's right.
But ready for Arrivederci Roma, huh? Yeah, you can be able to chime in some more times while you're there, because you said you can be there till March, huh?
Oh yeah, no, oh, great. I'll be here on Fridays.
Oh great.
Hey to the Pope for us.
I will look for your picture over the weekend. I looked through the ones I have, but I couldn't find it. But I get hypnotized as I'm going through them.
Because I'm going to have to take off. We'll see y'all next week.
Hey, take care.
Right. See you later, Rick. Take care.
I think New Haven had the most people in attendance. I'm sure. The
first one, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's because we're alive. Most of us were alive then.
That's true.
That is true.
That's true.
That's the crazy thing about it all.
Yeah.
Damn people dying.
Yeah.
What can you do?
Quite a few people passed just since the 50th reunion.
Yeah. But Carnegie was a big draw because it was Carnegie.
Yes. That was in New York, I think. I love going up to New York.
What a great memory. Next one will be in New Orleans.
There might be the six of us there.
Right.
I'll be there.
You don't count Roger.
Well, Christine said she would come and Banu would be there. So, you know, they might have a few extra.
And probably Christine if Banu was there.
Yeah. Yeah, Christine, she was on earlier. Did
she come back on since one time she was speaking? Couldn't get
one other time. She came back for a second visit.
Yeah, I missed that.
But she definitely said she would come down to New Orleans if we did one.
I think she would, but I don't think Joel would make it.
No, Joel wouldn't make it.
No,
I don't know if Maynard would make it either. I don't know how
he lives here.
I think Neil Underser is still playing around town, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know who else is. Who are the mustache musicians still around town? Barry, no, Fred Lonzo is, but I don't know if he'd come.
Yeah.
Well, since you're talking about people that died, we have to have a picture of Jeff.
Yeah,
that's a good picture.
I like that. Yeah. Happy faces.
That's one of the classic shots.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Christine still looks like that today.
Amazing. She has children, didn't she? Older children?
I think she has a daughter.
Daughter? That's what I was thinking.
Wow.
Yeah.
I knew still doing real well. I mean, she's still playing around town.
Well, that's good.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw it in a little article about her not long ago in the entertainment section. So she's still drawing crowds. Has her own little, and Danny plays around town too, you know. So now Barry's retired. We'll have to train him up on banjo again when we do the reunion here.
Barry, you miss playing Fritzels?
Not yet.
You will.
Not yet.
Eventually.
Not yet.
You'll start playing for. Teach the grandkids some how to sing Minnie the Mermaid.
Yeah.
Anyway. Well, Bonnie's giving me the high sign. I got to go pick up the fried fish. She's ordering some tonight.
Sounds good.
Well, thanks.
You'll be right
thanks, on. Everybody.
Thank you, Bill. See you guys next week.
All right.
Hey, what are you doing?
Okay.
All seven of us better be there.
Thank you, Tom.
Okay. All right, no problem.
Next week, see y'all later, guys.
Hasta luego.
Hasta luego. Okay. Arrivederci.